Human impacts have been quite large all around the world, but what exactly are these impacts? First is the impact we're having on habitat, how we're altering it and converting it to other purposes. This can be seen as a process of what's called habitat fragmentation, which creates islands of natural habitat out of what once was large, continuous ecosystems. So this is illustrated in this example with a map of Cadiz County in Wisconsin. In 1831, the entire county was covered in forest. But by 1882, much of that forest had been converted to farms. Fields were cleared, leaving just a few patches. This process continued, and by 1950, there were very few forest patches left. That's just one county in Wisconsin. Right now, this is happening on a much larger scale in the rainforests in Brazil. So you had what was once continuous rainforest over vast ranges of land, and now there are these smaller patches remaining. Madagascar went through this quite severely. The entire island, one of the largest islands on Earth, was predominantly covered with a rainforest on the east side and a dry forest on the west side. And these forests had been reduced to just tiny fragments by 1995. We view these habitat fragments as if they're islands, and there's a whole field of what's called island biogeography that looks at how many species exist and what happens to species on islands of different sizes. And there's a very recurrent pattern, which is that the smaller the island, the fewer the species that you'll find there. This is well illustrated from the study of plants in the Caribbean, where they've calculated the size of each island, the largest being Cuba and Jamaica, and the smallest being these, Redonda and Saba. And the number of species found naturally on each one of these islands is much greater on the larger islands, so much greater biodiversity on these big islands. These small islands have fewer species, and through time, they're more likely to go extinct. So you have less biodiversity the smaller the island, and the more likely you are to lose species from those small islands. Now, these island effects often occur because of what are called edge effects. This is back in the rainforest again. And so you have now what was once a large intact spread of forest, but now you've got these isolated fragments. And things can come in through the edges that might not otherwise affect the plants and animals that live there. So in this particular example, we see that there has been an effect of cutting down a batch of trees to expose a forest area as a fragment. And 200 meters inside from that edge, there's a change in the kinds of invertebrate species that live in the leaf litter and the dead leaves underneath. Trees themselves are more likely to die 200 meters within the edge. Relative humidity is altered 100 meters from the edge inwards, soil moisture, all of these things vary. So all of these things are going to put more strain onto an isolated patch of rainforest. I've studied a different kind of edge effect in looking at lions in East Africa. Lions are allowed to live inside a network of protected areas or national parks where this is their land. Inside the national park, the lions are completely protected. They're not subject to trophy hunting. People aren't supposed to bother them. But we put radio collars on the lions inside the park, and we found that they leave the safety of that reserve. And they go out into the edge area where there are people living. And some of them go right into villages outside the park. Now, when the lions get too close to people, they get very close to their livestock. And the lions do kill a lot of Maasai livestock around Tarangire National Park. Now, the Maasai don't like this at all, and when they lose their livestock to lions, they retaliate. And this shows that in a number of different villages around Tarangire, there are some villages where lions have attacked livestock up to 30 times, and nearly 30 lions were killed in retaliation. So where the lions kill more livestock, more lions are killed in retaliation. And this is an edge effect that is very profoundly important for the health of the lion population. Studies in the park itself shows that the population has been declining over the last 10 years, and it's actually dropped by about 25% because of these retaliatory killings. So, lions are sensitive to edge effects. How can they be protected against these problems? There are certain parks in Africa where the lions don't suffer retaliatory killings because they don't cause any problems in the first place. We see this in the Lake Nakuru National Park in Kenya, also in a number of parks in South Africa, like this one called Pinda Private Reserve. What we found is that if the lions are safely fenced in, then they don't get into trouble and their populations are really quite healthy. This is a graph that shows how well the lion population is doing. We can predict how many lions there ought to be in a particular area, and if they're being well conserved, the lion population should be about 100% status. If it's poorly protected, it might be only 10% of its potential. So there's a clear difference between the fenced parks and the unfenced parks. And if we extrapolate into the future, we see that all these fenced populations are likely to thrive well into the future. But in the unfenced parks, which is the most common configuration in Africa, that the boundary is just drawn on a map and has no real meaning, and the lions easily walk across the border and get in trouble outside the park. These areas, the lion populations are already low, like we see down here, and they're declining. And so we're predicting that the lions in Africa, of these unfenced populations, about half will be on the verge of extinction within the next 30 or 40 years. Beyond the habitat loss and alteration, humans are having a huge impact on global biodiversity because we move animals around. One of these results in what's called invasive species. An example of this that we've seen here in Minnesota is a plant called purple loosestrife. This was actually brought to Minnesota by somebody who wanted to have the same plants that they enjoyed seeing while they were living in England or somewhere and decided to plant them around their lakeshore property. Well, purple loosestrife then dominated many areas and is now the most common plant. It's forced out, it's outcompeted a lot of our native plants. There's a terrible thing called the zebra mussel. It's a small mollusk that came in the water of ships that had been docked somewhere else, and in their bilge water they came here, they cleared it out, and these zebra mussels arrived in our lakes and rivers. And it's a phenomenal growth of these little shelled animals that cover, I mean, that's like a coating of zebra mussels over what should otherwise just be driftwood and a few reeds. So phenomenal growth. Most recently now, there's a fish that has gotten into American rivers called the Asian carp. And the Asian carp has been breeding like crazy. It's not only knocking out a lot of different local species, but these things spook when they hear noises, and sometimes they jump into people's faces. We've even had fishermen getting damaged by having a carp slap it on the face. So all of these things have something in common: uncontrolled growth, because they've all been brought into a novel habitat where they don't have their normal predators, their normal parasites are not here, so their populations are not being limited by the usual controlling factors. And so with unrestricted population growth, these animals are a huge, huge threat to natural systems. The next human threat to global biodiversity is through overconsumption or overexploitation. It's been a feature of our species as we left Africa and started to occupy the rest of the world that our arrival signaled a huge loss in biodiversity. Now, we've always lived in Africa, and the animals that live in Africa are used to being around people. But as we moved to Australia and colonized Australia in the last 50,000 years, the number of different species that had been present in Australia prior to human arrival was really quite striking. And there's a lot of extinct species, giant kangaroos, giant wombats, giant birds, that all disappeared about the same time when the Aborigines first arrived. There were several waves of migration into the New World, and the one at 12,000 years ago coincided with, again, a huge die-off in the number of species that lived in North America and South America. species that we don't see anymore that were here just 10,000 years ago, giant sloths, saber-toothed tigers, phenomenal species that we don't see anymore, all disappeared with the arrival of humans. More recently, humans occupied Madagascar only in the last 1,500 years or so, New Zealand in the last 1,000 years, and again, human arrival, mass extinction. And the reason that this is happening almost certainly is that as humans occupied these areas, they had new sources of food, new animals to eat. And this is really emphasized by the observation from North America that it wasn't until the invention by early humans, the early Native Americans, of the Clovis point, that they now had a weapon that could very, very efficiently take down woolly mammoths and giant sloths and all of these things. And in fact, Europe, which had had animals surviving those first waves of human occupation for tens of thousands of years, again showed massive die-offs, woolly mammoths disappearing, actual lions, hyenas, a number of other things that disappeared about the time that humans had discovered how to make a very good, very efficient weapon for catching their prey. Just how well humans can knock out a species is emphasized from our own continent in the last several hundred years. It's estimated that in the year 1700, there were between 30 and 60 million bison that ranged all the way from northern Kenya down to Mexico. By the 1850s and 70s, this range had been restricted, and it continued to contract until there were only 931 individual bison left out of those 30 and 60 million just after 180 years. The species has recovered quite well, as now people say, oh, I like bison. And we have bison now in Yellowstone National Park. There's some up here in Canada, a few other places scattered around. We've made a conservation effort to try to recover bison population, but that's a very different attitude towards the bison today than dominated American policy in the 1800s. This is a deliberate extermination of a species. The Native Americans' livelihoods as hunter-gatherers depended largely on access to bison. So it was official policy to deliberately get rid of as many bison as they could, and a small number of people out there day and night shooting as many bison as possible did a great job at exterminating tens of millions of buffalo. Now, the passenger pigeon is an even more extraordinary story, and this one was not deliberate, unlike the bison. The passenger pigeon, once upon a time, was an incredibly abundant bird in North America. It's estimated that in the year 1600, there were between 4 and 5 billion passenger pigeons. That would be between a quarter and almost a half of all individual birds found on this continent were passenger pigeons. The scale of this species population is truly staggering. In Wisconsin, there was a single nesting where all the birds aggregated that covered an area of 850 square miles, and it's estimated there were 136 million birds. There were so many birds nesting on the oak trees that the weight of the birds would cause the branches to collapse. A phenomenally abundant species. During those days, the passenger pigeon, this phenomenally abundant species, migrated between the Great Lakes here in the upper Midwest to the eastern forests down in Virginia, Tennessee, places like that. But those forests were cleared. People decided they could make money by netting the flocks, shooting them. In this picture right here, somebody shooting up into a black cloud of birds and with a single shot felling a number of different individuals. The pigeons were so abundant, they were so cheap, they were sold at market for 50 cents a dozen. The species could not withstand that level of offtake. And so here's one of the most famous animals in American history. Her name is Martha. She's the last passenger pigeon. So here it says, last of her species. She died at 1 p.m. the 1st September 1914 at the age of 29 in the Cincinnati Zoo. The last one of an estimated 4 to 5 billion passenger pigeons. Next is pollution. We produce a lot of compounds for our needs that are escaping into the environment and having consequences on the world around us. I want to now focus on phosphate. That's one of the five essential components of DNA, an important limit on a lot of ecosystems. And this is a study from a small European country called Luxembourg. And in this particular study, they're focusing on water quality in a series of different streams in this very small country. So these three different streams here, they looked at a series of them. And what we see here is that where there are more people living on a certain watershed, there's more phosphates getting into the environment. And phosphorus is again a problem because it's such a limiting resource. And if humans start throwing phosphorus into the local environment, you get eutrophication. So this is the same kind of pattern we saw with nitrogen pollution in the last lecture. And this is now from phosphorus. So all of these are acting independently of each other. And we see that human activities in many ways are dominating our natural systems. We're inflicting multiple forms of harm.